Today we are talking about On Bullshit by Harry Frankfurt. Did somebody want to maybe start off with like kind of an overview?
I can try. I feel like I usually don't. So this is based on an essay by the same author from 1985 of the same name. He rewrote it as a book in 2005. It's called On Bullshit. It's a pretty short book. For me, I think it was like 64 pages or something like that. And most of it, if not all of it, is trying to find a good definition of what bullshit is, mostly by comparing it to other similar terms. He uses humbug, hot air, bull shooting the bull, and then definitions from Oxford English Dictionary and different literary sources, just trying to nail down a definition of what bullshit is. I think that's most of the book. He doesn't, a little disappointingly, doesn't really go into like the moral implications of using bullshit, and only briefly discusses why bullshit is so common in our society, and doesn't really have a stance on if it's more common now than it used to be. I think that covers most of the book, to be honest. Am I missing anything?
I think so, Ed. I think I gathered all that too, and then of course, like as I do, like I jumped into all this. You know, the sort of stuff around it. I don't know if you all saw the video on where he was on Jon Stewart, which was very short, but it covers one important like moral take on it, which is that bullshit is far worse than lying, right? Like he sort of has put them on this ethical spectrum, and he puts bullshit further to the bad side of that spectrum, lying. And then I think he also talks a lot about the rise of bullshit, like the increasing prevalence of bullshit. That's all.
Wow, great. I didn't finish that clip because it seemed like they weren't talking at all.
Yeah.
There was words being exchanged, but they weren't reaching.
Yeah.
You know, it was a really awkward interview. So I kind of quit. I pulled the plug halfway through.
Well, you know me, I'm an identity politics type of guy. And just watching this guy in person spoke so much to me, you know, just seeing how he is. And like, he's great. You know, if anyone's going to tell you about bullshit, I want it to be this guy, is basically what I got at.
He looked like a no bullshit guy.
Yeah, exactly. He's very.
He seemed like he was very carefully choosing the words he said. So Jon Stewart like kind of didn't want there to be any dead air, but he was really trying to think over how he responded to Jon's question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he definitely did not match the
energy,
the medium. Yeah,
he's not made for TV.
No,
I thought at the beginning of the essay that the essay itself was he would never actually define bullshit, and the essay itself would be like an illustration of bullshit. Although I turned out to be wrong, but I thought that would. That's where it was going. Because he does sort of give a couple, I would almost say like straw men to start. The like, because I felt like the humbug one was a little like, he's starting an essay by like attacking somebody else. And I'm kind of like, I don't know who this person is, but go get him. And then he talks about like why Wittgenstein was like such a dick. And I'm like, yep. But like, and then he finally gets into kind of the definition of bullshit, which I thought was pretty interesting.
It felt to me like the first chapter of a much longer book. Like, we got through like defining what it is, and then you can go and explore like all kinds of facets of how it like manifests itself in reality. I really do wish it was a lot longer. No, I'm glad that I actually finished a book for once. So
do you all agree?
Yeah. It's the first one, right?
Yeah, yeah, I think this is it. Yeah, 5 pages.
I mean, yeah, I have to scramble.
Eddie, you pretty much reread the book in your summary.
Yeah.
I had to scramble. I found the essay. I had read that. It's nice and short. It's even shorter than the book. And then I just was reading. You know, there's lots of stuff out there on this book. Sorry if I've missed anything important.
Doesn't sound like it. I ended up buying the book because I read online. It's like 80 pages. And I'm like, okay. And it shows up and it's like 3 inches by 5 inches. I think my phone is bigger than the book. And it's got about 4 words per line. And then I have to like jump to the next line. It's actually kind of difficult to read that way. So I kind of wish I did read the essay.
It's almost like it's a pocket manual.
Yeah, you can carry it around. And when somebody is bullshitting you, you pull it out and you throw
it on the table.
did you all... Okay, so wait. Let me try to maybe give his central thesis on what bullshit is. It sounds like the difference between lying and bullshit is that a liar cares about the truth enough to intentionally deceive or contradict it. Whereas a bullshitter is hiding not the truth, but the fact that they don't really care about the truth. Is that kind of accurate for what he was saying?
Yeah, it reminded me of like immoral versus amoral. This is like anti-truth versus a truth.
Mm-hmm. And so did you agree with that definition, or did everybody kind of agree with that definition?
I mean, I feel like it existed. It's so good to read this in the era of Trump having been president. Like Trump is the bullshitter, or was the bullshitter. I feel like we have such a great example in our hands.
Well, don't worry. We've got a new bullshitter in chief.
I know.
So I kind of felt like it wasn't a very clean division between the two for me, because I think it's actually kind of impossible to not care about the truth. Like, a bullshitter doesn't just say gibberish, right? Like, they say something that has to sound close enough to what, you know, the other person is expecting. So you do have to be, like, truth aware, right? You have to be, like, truth adjacent. And I think the bullshitter, you know, would have to at least have some suspicion about where the truth actually lies. So I'm a little skeptical that one can be completely atruthful in conversation.
I would defend his take on it. I think I saw a term I saw was like, the bullshitter has a disregard for the truth. It's not just that they, you know, work around the truth, but it's literally like, you know, like most of us normal people, we hold the truth in very high regard. And a bullshitter is so toxic because they brought the sort of, they've taken truthiness off of its pedestal. And that's almost offensive to like running a functional society.
I'm trying to think, is it possible that just two people have very different conceptions of what the truth may be? And like, okay, so I come in and I'm like, hey guys, like, you know, I'm working on my side hustle, you know, hoping to start making $100,000 selling essential oils. Mm. And you're like, oh, that's bullshit. That's not, you know, how it works. That's not the truth. And in my mind, I'm actually under this, you know, my conception of reality is that one could in fact do that. Maybe I've read about it. Maybe somebody lied to me, but like, you know, bullshit is produced in the, you know, in the receiver, or the receiver thinks bullshit, but the producer might still think that they're speaking the truth, I guess.
And they're not bullshitting under his definition.
So, yeah, right. And I'm trying to like then find an instance where somebody actually is bullshitting. Like, could we explain all instances of bullshit with just like people have different takes on what something means to be true?
Wow. No, I mean, this resonated with me a lot. Like, and I would challenge Fran a little bit when you said that most people aren't bullshitters. Like, I think of myself as, and this is like a problem I have, like a semi-competent but compulsive like bullshitter. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, especially at work, especially like when I first started working, I bullshit all the time because I didn't want to get in trouble or I wanted my boss to like me. And I actually got called out on it by my boss. But I would I would have an idea of what I wanted people to think of me, and I would say kind of whatever it took to get them to think of me in that way, without any regard for how close that it was to like accurate. So that's what my like model of bullshitting was when I was reading this.
I want to welcome Dylan, who just popped in.
Hi, Dylan.
Hello.
We were kind of discussing if we agreed with his definition of bullshit.
So if I can Dylan. Continue to defend, you know, the definition, Frankfurt's definition. He does. I don't know where it is, but somewhere he says that with the rise of more information, like the, you know, just the rise of more communication, everyone talking all the time and lots of media and whatnot, the prevalence of bullshit has gone through the roof. Not necessarily the proportion of the proportion of bullshit to non-bullshit in communication perhaps has not changed, but the fact that we have an overwhelming amount of is allowing for more bullshit. And he refers to something about like he makes a specific point at some point, at any point in time, that someone is forced to talk about something that they don't know anything about. For example, this oils example. Then bullshit is like, I agree with you, Ed, that we all bullshit and we're all bullshitters because we're frequently put in these positions right now, included potentially. I might be bullshitting. I don't know. But right now included, like we're put in these positions where we're forced to talk about something that we don't necessarily have a good grasp of.
So okay, I guess if we can reframe what I'm saying as like, I don't think that bullshitters exist. Maybe we could try to just all find somebody that we agree is a bullshitter. And if we can't do that, then maybe.
Well, that'd be fun.
Mike, is this an argument like if everyone's special, no one's special kind of thing?
I think
that if everyone's a bullshitter, there's no bullshitters.
Not quite. I guess what my point would be is that everyone is to some degree concerned with the truth. It's just that our method of perceiving the truth varies from person to person. So from like an outside position, it looks like somebody's bullshitting, but subjectively, they could just have some very strange beliefs that they think are true, and you know they're not intentionally being deceptive for the sake of being deceptive. But I don't know. I'm very open to being wrong about this.
Well, wasn't one of his points that intent doesn't matter? That sincerity is bullshit.
He does say that sincerity is. I mean, I sort of took that to mean that everybody was a bullshitter. If the idea of sincerity is actually bullshit. I think that was like the very last paragraph or something, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the end. I forgot how he arrived there, though, honestly.
Yeah, I'm pulling it up.
I want to... Oh, sorry, what, friend?
No, I'm just saying I'm pulling it up, but it is right at the end. It's his last line.
Okay, so I want to use Trump as, like, a case study in bullshit, but I will be forced to take the position of defending the truthiness of Trump, and I don't want to do that. So maybe there's somebody else, yeah, who is like less heinous to support.
I mean, Alex Jones.
You don't have to just say a person is a bullshitter. You can like talk about a specific instance of what somebody might call bullshitting, and then I'm just curious to see like in what way it wouldn't be bullshitting. Like, I don't mean to take the in a different direction, but if I was in a job interview and they asked me like how my performance in college was, and I said, all the teachers loved me. I did great. I was a great student. I was super organized. I know, like, if I really like dig down, I know that none of that is true, but I'm not concerned with telling the truth or telling a lie. I'm just concerned with the job interviewer liking me or thinking I'm a good candidate. That I would call
getting the job.
Yeah, getting the job is the goal.
I would say I would say in that case that you are actively lying. Like, you know what the truth is and you are not presenting the truth to pursue some other motive beyond establishing true or false. Like, you're not lying for the sake of lying, which I think would actually sort of be closer to what a bullshitter is, but rather you're lying to achieve like personal gain.
That's when he starts talking about Augustine, how St. Augustine
had
9 types of lying and 8 of them could conceivably be called like bullshit.
I thought it was
if you're not lying, you're not trying.
Say it again, Mike? Sorry.
I think Augustine called out 1 as bullshit, not the 8. I think the 8 were all lies to an end, but then the 1 was just lying for the sake of lying, which...
No, well, that was the only, I think what he was saying was that was the only true lie is when you just lie to lie. The rest of them are lying toward, like, you could conceivably skew that to say they're lying to get to an end and they're not, like, actually concerned with the truth or not.
Well, if I can jump in, I'm finding, like, a sort of corollary, like, modern warfare, right? Like, is everyone familiar with this idea that, like, the way that the United States conducts wars now is, like, to pit the sides against each other and then just basically, you know, they'll force a civil war so that way
since when were we not at constant war?
Yeah, then there's the wars that we actually engage in, right? Like, but that's wait, let me finish this. I think when I think of, if we're going to talk about intent, I think of the intent of the bullshitter as to disorient, right? Like the way that they gain power is to basically just leave a wake of disorientation behind them. So that way they're always on top and they're always in front. If we're going to talk about, I'm unclear if Frankfurt really cares about, or if he's more just talking about.
I think the intent is the critical piece of his argument, though.
Okay.
I mean, that was just my understanding, is that like a liar's intent is different than a bullshitter's intent, but the product is the same, which is something that is not true. What were you gonna say, Dylan?
You say like with an example of a bullshitter, then would be like Trump saying like I had the best biggest inauguration ever. You know what I mean? Like is that an example?
So I didn't want to defend Trump, but now I have to. So why would he say something that we know is a lie? And I would make a couple of points. One is that a bullshit wants to deceive that they don't care about the truth. And he is being pretty open. He knows that he will be perceived as not caring about the truth. So in that sense, I would say that this is like more of a strategy that he's doing, a means to achieve some other end. And so it is a lie, but it is a lie that factors into like a path that he believes to be the true path to get to where he's going. So I would argue in that sense, he is actually concerned about a truth, just not the same truth that we are, which is like the news should report things that have happened.
I think in the case of the inauguration, I really do think the intent of bullshit is to disorient. I'm going to double down on that. And I think in the case of the inauguration, Trump's intent there, you know, at first, yeah, it was a lie, but the bullshitting consistent, right? When you put a photo in front of Trump and he just looks at you right in the face and says, yeah, that's a massive, you know, that crowd is huge. You can't see a single piece of grass on the field. And like, you're looking at the picture and you're like, the grass is right there. That's where the bullshit comes in. And you're literally just like, what is happening? You know, you just fall apart because you don't, it just doesn't make sense. I think that's but maybe I'm wrong.
Yeah, I mean, that feels like bullshit for sure. Like when you and somebody else experience the same thing, you're looking at the same picture and they refuse to admit what you yourself are empirically observing. I would maybe, yeah, I don't know that you can look at a picture with nobody in it and say it's a full crowd. I'm not sure what part of your subjective experience would have to be like arranged to have that perception.
Well, wasn't it fantastic with this most current inauguration that there really was no crowd? I just thought it was fantastic how the entire media was like, sounded like North Korea, but you know, no one was there.
I think it's still a lie. I think it's still a lie because the only way I think we just have to assume that Trump can like see the same visual, you know, stimulus that we can, you know, would see that there is nobody in it and then choose to say the opposite of what he experiences. Like, to me, that fits the criteria of being a lie because he knows the truth. He knows what the truth is, and then he chooses to represent something else. Unless,
see, I don't think he knows the truth.
Well, I don't think any of us.
I think he fully embodied most perfectly, you know, the fake it till you make it. I mean, literally everything about him is fake, but somehow, you know, he's fake rich, he's fake, but it's also it's all real.
Yeah.
He was kind of an amazing guy in that way, you know. It'll be hard to top him as a president.
I think the gas camps will probably be the next step. So I think in that sense, it's going to be pretty easy to top him. Oh. I think we'll look back and kind of miss the guy.
Oh, no, I mean the spectacle of it. See, now the gas camps will be respectable. You know, we're going to have clear order. We're going to have all the rituals. We'll be tied up in a bow. No mess.
Is this during the Ivanka Trump presidency that we're having gas camps?
Oh, no. Yeah, this is very near future.
This is Barron Trump presidency.
Okay.
Before we get too black-pilled, I wanted to ask another question. What did you guys make of the bull session, which is where he says people suspend the pretense of truth in order to try out different, I guess what we would say is just, you know, statements that don't make any claim to being true, just to sort of see how they land, to try them on. Hmm. Is that a fair categorization of bull session?
I don't know if it's a fair categorization. I don't think I've ever used that term, and I don't hear it used that often. I feel like it's kind of outdated, but I'm glad you brought it up, because I thought that was like just an interesting idea that I hadn't heard, that I wish you expanded on a little more. Like having a group of people where you all have like a common agreement that whatever you say is just kind of like testing the waters. It's not like resolutely like exactly what you believe. Mm-hmm.
This is kind of a bull session, no?
Well, I thought
with you.
I always aspire to be a part of. To make every social conversation I'm a part of a bull session. Only the guys get to speak. No,
I guess I felt like it was kind of a disingenuous categorization or definition of a bull session, because I don't think that there is this like truthless vacuum in a bull session. Like when people are trying on things, when people are like saying things and seeing how they land, that's not just for the sake of, you know, making guttural noises. Like it is to, you know, empirically test out our beliefs against other people to see if they hold water. And if they get a good reception, then they become our beliefs. Like the products of bull sessions are carried long after the bull session ends.
Oh, yeah. But I mean, Mike, I think you have to transcend his way of thinking here. You know, like, you know, just like in a certain sense, it feels like, you know, that he gave that example of Wittgenstein, you know, and the woman who came home and said, oh, I feel like I was like a run over dog, you know, and it's like, language is poetic and symbolic, you know. To expect it to be literal is kind of to lose something important about it.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, I mean, I think ultimately a bull session is basically like one in which people aim to discover truth in a setting that is fundamentally unconducive to truth. Like it's basically trying to derive what we end up holding to be our, you know, our beliefs from not like testing them out with research or, you know, serious logical validation, but rather just seeing people's response to it.
And then if I can jump
in, category error.
I appreciated this section on the bull session. Speaks all too disparagingly about it. And I think, have you ever heard of the term external processing? You know, some of us are like external process. I definitely am in this category where I don't really know what I'm going to say until it's already out of my mouth. In a lot of ways are developed through my conversations rather than spoken. You know what I mean? I think there's this assumption that lots of thoughts are developed internally and then we speak them out loud and edit and revise what was. But I'm, you know, I totally relate with this bull session thing where it's like, I don't know what I think until I say it out loud. You know, that's.
Yeah, I think the most.
Nathan?
Oh, I was just going to say, I think the most effective way to learn is once you feel like you understand something to try and explain it. Because once you try, you realize very quickly like where you're lacking.
Right.
And so it very easily allows you to hone in on like where you're unclear about a topic or subject. And, you know, then you can further elaborate.
So I definitely agree with you that our ideas and beliefs are, you know, not a product of our conscious, you know, thinking, but rather a product of our unconscious. And our unconscious is something that's been assembled through, you know, our interactions and conversations and, you know, ways that we've interpreted experiences and stuff like that. And that's all part of like you said, you know, this social process. Once something is out of my mouth though, I don't think that as a conscious thinker, I am in any position to then take that to be more than just the product of my unconscious. Like, I'm not sure that I can then say, yeah, that sounded really good. And I think that's true. Like, I think that's a jump basically from like, you know, something that is a something held prison by your subjective experience and you're trying to burst through to make some sort of objective claim. Like, it's just something that can't be done. I'm not butchering Kant too badly.
Well, I wouldn't say it's objective for sure, but, you know, I think you yourself, when you say it, have a certain feeling, you know, or sense of like, yeah, no, that's not it. Or, you know, like Eddie was talking earlier about, you know, earlier in life, how he'd, you know, be saying things just to impress others. And I can very much relate to that. That's like every word that exited my mouth in my 20s, you know, was like, just like wanting to appear a certain way to other people, you know, so that they think I'm, you know, smart or, worthwhile in some way.
We definitely do that. I'm not saying that we don't do it. I guess what I'm saying is just that, like, let's say you say something and, you know, it feels great. It lands, it makes sense intuitively. People, you know, agree with you. Again, you know, that doesn't make it any truer. I think it just means that, like, it, you know, it's part of this, like, subjective, you know, reality, this subjective meaning that you're building in your mind, but it's still not, like, truth. And I think that Harry Frankfurt is really trying to talk about objective truth in a way that is, I think, at least fundamentally inaccessible through, like, conversation.
Does he try to talk about objective truth, or does he talk about does it just matter what the speaker believes to be true?
Okay, well, I'd be actually kind of curious what your all definition of truth is.
I do think on that section on sincerity, he does acknowledge that this sort of, is it relativism? I don't know what exact term he uses, but, oh no, here it is. May I read out loud real quick?
Go, please.
The contemporary proliferation of bullshit also has deeper source in various forms of skepticism, which deny that we can have any reliable accent objective reality, and which therefore reject the possibility of knowing how we truly are. So he's saying that bullshit does have a source in a denial of an objective reality.
Yeah, and I think that, like, what Kant would say, and then, like, everybody that Kant has influenced, is that, like, yeah, the objective thing in itself is fundamentally inaccessible because we're trapped in this subjective experience. And so I think Harry Frankfurt does not share that point of view. And I think that makes sense because he's more, like, of the analytical tradition, where Kant is continental.
Well,
I
was just gonna say, I also picked up on that, and that, like, when I digested this a little bit, I had this moment of just like, wait, is this philosophy? Like, if to even have that stance to me feels non-philosophical, to assume that there is an objective reality. I don't know about you.
Well, isn't that?
Yeah, my personal opinion is that philosophy doesn't really take place in the realm of seeking objective truth. I think it's more of like constructing meaning, but that's sort of my take on it.
Likewise.
But I'd be interested to hear other people. Like, I mean, I do think that we have...
Well, it's kind of both. I'm somewhere in the middle there.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, to me, science is really what more purports to grant us access to, you know, to objectivity through, you know, through empirical observation, which philosophy, at least most of the philosophy I've read, is something that you can't really empirically verify. Like Freud, for example, you know, I think is a wonderful philosopher, but, like, good luck trying to find the ego, you know, under a microscope.
Yeah. Well, I also have this sort of like scientific lens, and I think of good science or, you know, I love science, right? Like, I just think of it all as science.
Would you say you fucking love science?
I fucking love it. But it's about an attempt at the truth, right? Like, it's our best attempt at the truth, or an attempt that we're willing to revise. I think that's always where I stand on truth, is like, yeah, like, close enough. You know, like, we're never gonna get there. We're never gonna achieve truth, but we get closer and closer. It's always worth trying.
So I think this is where, and at least in my view, like, theory sort of separates from observation. So, like, I definitely think that we have real experiences. Like, if I get hit by a car, I definitely got hit by a car. I'm not going to dispute that. But then once I start trying to connect all of my, you know, my experiences, then I have entered into more the realm of theory and, like, a priori knowledge, something that, like, you know, explains or precedes the experiences themselves. Whereas, you know, the knowledge that I have, which is basically what I have experienced directly, is, you know, is true only when it's disconnected from theory. So you can have scientific observations, and then the actual theory behind it is something that is more in the realm of, I want to say subjectivity, but there's probably a better word.
Well, I hear you. I think of it as, I don't know where I read it once, but it was like an essay called The Contingency of Lane. I was talking about like these paradigm shifts, right? Where at one time, I don't know, or even like within a certain cult, getting hit by a car is salvation and crazy like that, right? Like, and how malleable humans are. That is the sort of beauty of our species, is that we can literally have any, you know, reality can be so, its definition can be redefined so much, it's so frequently, like within the same species, we have totally different lenses on what is real, which I think throws into question the whole idea of real.
Yeah, to me, reality is like the theory that tries to connect our empirical observations. So like, if you get hit by a car and then ask like, why, then you have like left the realm of empiricism and then like entered the realm of like theory and idealism and like a priori knowledge.
But if you're Trump, you might just say, I never hit that per my car. That never happened. Then or insist. Sorry, I'm just being a smart ass, but yes, I agree with
you. No, I think it's an important point you're raising. I guess Yeah, I mean, it's so interesting because you really do need to have a definition of what true is to distinguish between like lying and bullshit. And if you claim that we don't have access to the truth, as I'm doing, then there really is no difference between lying and bullshit. But if you're Harry Frankfurt and you think that you can access objective truth, then I suppose that you could separate the two.
Well, isn't there like a metaphysical level or like a hard philosophical level of truth and then just like a practical everyday level of truth? Like, we could discuss like, I'm trying to think of an example. Like if I told everybody my hair was red, you could discuss like whether or not that's knowable. But in a practical sense, I would be lying. And I think that's the kind of lie, but knowledge of what the truth is that he's referring to. I don't know if it goes as deep as you're looking.
I agree, Ed. I landed on a similar sort of, in a similar place, just contemplating Michael's question. And I think—
Well, what if you were, oh, sorry, Trent.
Let me just finish this thought quickly, which is that that's where I landed also just thinking about Frankfurt. Like, is this philosophy or is this sociology? Is this like an opinion column, some publication? It feels more like sociology, philosophy, because it is talking about the more easily grasped rather than the philosophical.
Yeah, I think I would say that's probably because we've been reading more continental philosophy and that this is sort of illustrating the divide between the two traditions. Because I think you will come across this a lot in analytical philosophy of what he's doing.
Okay.
The other thing is like, Eddie, if you say your hair is red and we all know that that's a lie, let's pretend for a moment there's like a tribe on an island and the language that they have developed, and it's pretty similar to ours, except that the word brown or the word for brown is pronounced red. And you say to them, my hair is red and you have, or sorry, black. You say my hair is red and you have black hair. That would be true to them.
Wait, Michael, do you know that this is a real case scenario for ancient Japan? They used to use the word blue to define anything that was on the cool side of the spectrum. And it wasn't until Western contact that they started to discern between green and purple. And they still, to this day, call some things blue that to us appear green, but it's just a holdover from...
Chinese as well. You know, green and blue are like closer to each other because it's like... It's kind of originates with or similar to like water, you know, how like in like we have rivers really nearby that kind of represent this like Opal Creek, you know, where if you have really clear, just perfect water, it's kind of green.
Right.
Yeah. And
I was just going to say it's more like blue and azure or blue and green actually kind of translate closer to like azure.
Right.
I think what we're touching on is like linguistic structuralism, which is that the structure of our language ends up shaping the way that we perceive reality. That's a pretty dominant theme in a lot of philosophy right now.
Yeah, I'm on board.
Even Pinker would have a fit about this conversation. I know Nathan loves that.
What's up?
So our very access to reality then, or what we
no,
think
Eddie,
of our,
what was that?
Oh, Stephen Pinker.
Stephen Pinker pretty strongly disagrees with the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis, which is what Fran and Michael are talking about. I don't know enough about the actual academics behind it to have a view on it, but I know that it is like a debated concept.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, structuralism was huge in philosophy.
Wait, I mean, you just mean in the sense that meaning comes, like, he disagrees that meaning comes from the web of relations between words?
He's going to make the argument that words have a specific meaning, that they're not arbitrary, and they're not, like, given meaning by society and their position in relation to other words. Is that?
I know his position is that specifically, and I think he might have actually referenced what Fran was talking about earlier, that the language that you know can influence your perception of reality. He thinks that is overplayed by the Sapir-Whorf hypothesis.
Oh, well, you mean, is this the whole idea that like, to take a more ridiculous example, like what the bleep, like that, like when the Columbus's ship sailed to America, like when they were arrived on the shore, like the Indians couldn't see them because they didn't have a word for ship.
Oh, were we talking? I feel like I brought this up recently. It's such a, I hate that.
No, it's complete utter horseshit. But I just wonder, is that what, I mean, that's kind of the extreme of what you're saying. Like, oh, if you don't have the word for it, you don't.
So Nathan,
see it.
What I'll say, you don't actually
see the colors.
Certainly, they've seen things floating in the water. Yeah. I mean, they had to have had a word to describe their experience.
But what seen wood.
And what I'll say is, I haven't heard that example, but like a more concrete, an example that we can probably all relate with is the sort of digital paradigm, right? Like, we live in this world where like a floppy disk means is the save icon, you know.
Exactly.
We have these streams of photos on our computer. If you gave a computer to someone from 100 years ago, they would literally like vomit in confusion because there's none of this makes sense, right? Like it's a totally different, I would say a totally different linguistic paradigm. There's lots of different sort of communication things happening on this screen that just don't make sense world.
And I've never read Pinker, so I don't really want to straw man him, but I'm gonna. and I think where he arrives at this is probably just because so many people have the same word for the same thing. And so many people, you know, phrase things the same. And, you know, I think that's what he might point to is that implying some sort of objectivity underlying it. I think that's just proof of how interconnected we are and how pervasive our language and culture plays in structuring our unconscious.
I agree.
So we're basically all affected by this, which is why we have such similar meaning.
I agree. I think it's an indicator of how much further back the monoculture on planet began, right? Like this, you know, there's this sort of connection to astrology across all civilizations on the planet. I don't think that all humans always had that religious foundation, but we killed them all.
I don't know Stinkers. that's my new name for him, Stinker. Anyways, I don't know Stinker's exact point. I definitely want to find a way to disagree with him. You know, I though unfortunately I do believe that from a lot of the examples I've heard, you know, the idea that like, oh, you needed to have a word for it to like see the different like colors or whatever is a little silly. But there, you do definitely get different like idea relationships. I don't know how to put it. Like I've read a lot of like books that ran out of like the translator hadn't finished it. So, you know, I kind of went to like machine translation for like certain Chinese books. And, you definitely get when you just like have a stupid computer kind of giving you what it thinks, you know, and it you end up with a lot more literal, but kind of ridiculous. You know, it seems a little ridiculous, but then you kind of figure out the pattern yourself. You can see like what it means and kind of go backwards with it. I don't know. I you do have a very different sort of, I want to say constellation in terms of like you have different words, but then how words relate to each other, like what they're kind of.
So let's pretend. Oh, sorry.
No. Go.
I was going to say. I was going to try to explain this from like Lacan. Do you know Lacan? Or heard of him? He was a psychoanalyst after Freud.
I've listened to Zizek.
Okay, cool. Yeah, I mean, and he is
way
too
much.
Very much. He's very much like a linguistic structuralist. So I mean, he's perfect for describing this. So like, let's say we all experience this like blast of light that at 560 hertz or megahertz or whatever. I don't even know what color that is. Let's pretend it's red, but let's call it like, let's try to describe it in more like, you know, objective terms, I guess. What Lacan would say is that we do experience this thing, but in order for it to mean anything, we have to be able to describe it with language. And so it's kind of like agnostic as to what the language actually is. But in order for it to like enter our subjective experience as like a phenomena, as opposed to like, you know, a noumena, which is more of like the objective side of it, according to Kant, then we have to be able to describe it in language. So anything that we can't describe in language is literally outside of our subjective experience and is inaccessible to it. And tracing this back, like what is the origin of language then? So, or do you want me to keep going? I don't want to suck all the air out of the room.
Oh, dude, bullshit. You keep bullshitting, son.
I've been reading
Don't you stop till you get somewhere.
So the very first thing that we learn, according to Lacan, we're born into sort of this undifferentiated state with the mother. We're part of her body. She's part of ours. It's this unity. And the very first thing that we notice subjectively is when the mother has a desire other than for us, in many cases, like for the father or something like that. And the signifier, basically the way in which we encode that in our unconscious becomes the very first thing that we learn. And then I guess it would follow from there, all of language acquisition builds off of that original first word, which according to Lacan is like the name of the father. But I mean, I think you could probably put something else in there. Basically, whatever the thing that kicks us out of unity into the subjective experience. That's kind of the kernel of it.
Who is it that like talks a lot about like categorization? We start off with that is my caretaker and that is not my caretaker. And that's like our distinction. You categorize everything caretaker and slowly diversify that ladder. So now that's food and that's not food and that's peas and that's not peas. Slowly work your way towards grasping, which I appreciate.
Yeah, that sounds right. Being able to produce peas from an undifferentiated mass of something lacking peas.
I'm on board. I feel like we should all agree on this. I bet we do. But when I think about Frankfurt, I almost think he's talking much more narrowly. I think he's talking about bullshit. He's talking about this very specific cultural phenomenon. He's kind of disregarding, you know, multiculturalism and relativism. He's just like, yeah, I'm just talking about the world here and now in the United States.
So I guess how could we formulate bullshit in this like more continental structuralist point of view. Like, does bullshit still exist? Or does bullshit only exist when you take the view that objective reality can be accessed? Because I bet we could still point out bullshit, even while holding that, you know, our subjective experience is fundamentally limited.
Do you think so? I hate to constantly have a response, but my response to that is, I think that, you know, much like in Chinese language, there's like diphthongs that you use to indicate different words, right? In English, the United States, bullshit is just one of the modes of communication. I might say fuck yeah in a positive way, or I might say fuck yeah in a bullshitting way. And it's like, if you're really to the language and the culture, then you can pick up on the sort of variation occasion.
Yeah, and I think that's kind of like putting it within a phrase almost, except the other words in the phrase is more of like body language than actual words.
Yeah.
It's sort of like how, like, if you say water, it can mean, you know, you're asking for water from a waiter. It could mean you found like a leak in your basement. It could mean, you know, you're answering a question like, what does ice melt into, right? But only by like placing that word within, you know, a phrase or placing it in opposition to other words does the meaning become clear.
Right.
I would also maybe just make the case that like bullshit is different than lying because two different words exist. I mean, if they were the same, how would we actually have two different words, even though we're very bad at determining the difference between them? Like, what explains this phenomenon of like two words meaning the exact same thing? Like, how could that possibly happen?
Well, because they're not the same. I mean, obviously, right? I mean,
well, so do you believe that there's no such thing as like a synonym?
No, there's synonyms, but you know, what is it? It's denotation, annotation, you know, like they got a different flavor. Like you got chocolate ice cream, but like it varies brand to brand, you know, maybe even season to season. Like, language is a living thing because we're living beings that use it to facilitate information, you know, between us.
Well, I really
and
don't
it
think,
grows as we grow.
I don't think bullshit and lying are synonyms. I wonder if we should continue your experiment that you proposed earlier, Michael, where we try and pick someone who we can all agree is a bullshitter. You know, like I think that somewhere in here we were doing all these puns earlier in the politics text chat. Nathan said this thing, "I'll pray for your soul," and Michael goes, "It's bullshit." And I'm like, yes, that is bullshit because I literally can't even comprehend. You know, I don't quite understand what.
Well, okay, here's a perfect situation. Nathan, did you intend to say bullshit when you said, "Fran, I'll pray for your soul"?
I mean, sort of, in the sense that like everything I say is bullshit. Like, it's more poetic. Or I was feeling like I needed to send some prayers, you know, Fran's way when I see him posting video being losing himself over Pod Save America meets Ezra Klein like that. I feel like someone's lost in the desert.
Pause there, Nathan.
And he needs some guidance.
Because this is a perfect example, Michael. Because
yeah,
I'll pray for your soul is not a lie. It's just bullshit. Like, there's no abscond, there's no like obscuring of the truth there. It's more just like this sort of weird manipulation of language. It's like it's just a next level use of language.
Yeah, because there is sincerity in it. I think what the sincerity is not that he will literally, not that Nathan will literally pray for your soul, right, but just that
I literally put my hands together and sent those
wait, no,
sent
Nathan,
those
not,
words
not,
to the great beyond.
I think the sincerity is that he's concerned about the effect of listening to Ezra Klein
right
on your character or formulation of your beliefs or whatever, which I think
I was worried about his emotional response to Ezra Klein at Save America.
Did you listen
to it? One of the Johns, right?
I don't want to get carried away, but did you listen to it? It was so good.
No, I haven't.
Okay, so then
I will just walk through darkness with you. I'll do that.
This comes down to, I think, then a fundamental misunderstanding by Nathan of Fran's intention, because Fran was not saying, "Oh, I've been subjected to Ezra Klein." Fran is saying,
"I know."
Like, Fran is saying, "Like, oh, this is excellent."
Oh, I trust me, Mike, I very much understood that. He wouldn't need prayers otherwise. He wouldn't need a force greater than myself.
Nathan, I wrote...
I'll jump on your side here. But these poor lost souls.
I guess I do think, and it seems to be maybe that others think the same, is that there was sincerity in Nathan's message, just not the words he used. In the same sense that, like, behind sarcasm, there is sincerity. Behind like irony, there is sincerity. It's just not the direct colloquial understanding of the phrase that was uttered.
Yes.
So it's basically
I was sincere. You know,
you're basically redefining language. You're turning "I'll pray for you" from a, you know, a prayer warrior, "I've got your back," like thing of support, to I don't know. I don't want to be pejorative, but like not that.
Mike, have you ever like? Oh, I don't know. I mean, how do you call it? There's baggage associated, right, with that phrase. There's There's a
okay. Yeah, because I feel like
we're touching on. In a certain sense, the same way, like I also, through that, I kind of wanted to communicate the distance between myself and Fran, you know, that just, I mean, because, I mean, who, like, no one of you prays, right? Like, that's not at all a sincere practice in your life, you right. know, like, you don't have that sort of belief, you
right.
know?
You knew that
so in a certain sense, when I wrote that, I was also trying to bring in other associations in that just how distant, you know, that I, in a certain sense, I am praying, you know, for him, you know, I am far enough away from being able to appreciate that interview in the same way, you know, or I should say those people. I actually haven't listened to the interview.
Okay, wait, but are you saying now that you actually did intend to say that you were praying for him?
No, yeah, that was sincere. But, you know, I think Frank like... would agree with me that it's also bullshit.
Wow. 'Cause I feel like... Oh, sorry, Eddie?
I think it's just hyperbolic. Like, he's not physically actually putting his hands together and praying, but he wants to express that sentiment, right? Like, that's different than bullshit.
Okay, I think what we're touching...
Sometimes I do put my hands together and pray, though.
I think we're...
Not often, but...
Are there instances,
I was being hyperbolic as well.
Are there instances, Edward, when hyperbole falls into the category of bullshit? I would say probably frequently.
Oh,
it might be one
yeah.
of the main characteristics of...
Yeah, I would agree with you. I can name one off the top of my head, but I'm sure you could find a lot.
And if I may dig into our chat history here, there's this other one that feels like bullshit. The Ed with the Ray Kurzweil moment. Because there was...
Yeah,
the,
I missed that.
There was, so you all were talking about this sort of like futurist, you know, like gene editing thing. And I just popped in. So it was this funny moment where it was just like, wow, Ed had this moment of empathy, right? Like if I had just popped into this, I would have no idea what's going on. I thought we were going to talk about bullshit, where genetics. And then he sends this text message that's pure bullshit because it's believable to me. It's like he's pulling my leg. You know, I think that people use for bullshit. It's like sort of pulling my leg in a playful way, not in any sort of like mean way, but just like a bullshitting kind of way where the truth is right there, but he's sort of just, he's not making it any easier to access.
I just felt like I was completely lying. Like it was a joke, obviously, but it was predicated on.
Oh, okay. I see what you're saying. I thought Ed said something in chat about Ray Kurzweil, but he put it in the Discord.
But and Ed, it's not a lie because if you were only hearing what Nathan and Michael were going back and forth about, you might believe that lie. So it's not a pure
That's a good
lie.
Joke, though.
It's believable, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
that's very funny. That was a good one, Ed.
That's what I'm here for.
Okay.
I think what we're like approaching is like this phenomenon that like there's more meaning than in just the word. And there's also more meaning in the arrangement. So like if I say water, like it can mean a lot of things that hasn't yet been specified. And then I say water, please. And now we know what I meant by water. But even further than that, there's like this third, you know, piece of the context, which is what's been left unsaid. So in the case of what Nathan's saying, like, we all know that praying doesn't do anything. I mean, no offense if anybody's religious, but like that is the unsaid. And when Nathan says,
well, I don't know about that, honestly.
Okay, but like let's pretend.
I've got doubts.
Let's pretend for a second that like that was the implicit understanding. Then when somebody says, I'm praying for you, like we know that the thing that puts it in context, in the final context, is that the speaker doesn't actually believe in prayer, and that's what transforms it from like something that's meant to be taken at face value into something that has this like invisible level of meaning to it. And I think that that's maybe something that structural linguistic structuralism doesn't, at least as far as I've encountered, address. It probably does. I don't know a lot about structuralism.
I feel like for this type of conversation, we're better off reading like Wittgenstein or something like that.
I don't.
Cat is not a cat.
please no. I have a copy of the Tractacus, and it looks so fucking masochistic to get through.
Yeah, I don't know. I didn't get much further than the world is all that is the case. That's all I really remember from it. I know that we're supposed to remain silent about what we don't know as well, but yeah, I've heard his later stuff's better.
I mean, that's sort of the quintessence of what we're talking about, right? Wittgenstein saying of what one cannot know, one must remain silent. And I think human behavior.
Yeah, but what's the fun in that?
Fundamentally contradicts that. Like literally.
Yeah. Have you seen the house he designed?
No.
I think you can judge people somewhat based on like the products or art they create. His house was just lifeless. No one wanted to live in it. I think the only people who could stand living in it were like Eastern Bloc, like Soviets, you know?
Looks like a prison.
It became like a Soviet embassy.
Interesting.
Sorry, what's that?
It looks like a prison. This is like a horror house, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, he didn't know any, like whatever he knew about philosophy was in direct opposition to life
Well, he was another analytic philosopher, so I think that that kind of is like maybe taken to the extreme of like words have a specific meaning as opposed to the meaning of words is situational, like others might say.
Right.
Yeah, or that it changes. I mean, I think that's the most important thing to note is just that words meaning changes over time, use changes over time.
Yep.
You know, connotation changes over time. You know, it changes because we change, because, you know, nothing's static. Everything flows.
Yeah. And we have this inherent tendency to resist that change because it's a constant expenditure of energy to learn new things and keep up. We kind of just want to not worry about it. Mm. It's like an inconvenient truth for us.
Wasn't that kind of the death drive or the Nirvana principle? We just want to like reach a static state.
Yeah. I kind of liken it more to like, we don't want a bumpy ride. We want a smooth ride. And so like, we want to be going somewhere, but we don't want to get like distracted along the way. Whereas like the Nirvana principle would be like, I hope my car crashes. Maybe not. I don't know. I do like the Nirvana principle.
Well, I mean, it's kind of the cessation of desire, right? It's like we want to cease wanting.
Yeah. To just become one with the universe, to stop being conscious, I would say.
Just a nice little human in the matrix. Yeah. Just in our little bat goo.
And so Lacan talks a lot about this, which is that once we have been ejected from the mother, or in a more general sense, the other, as he calls everything that's not us, but in the beginning, the mother is the other, it creates this like hole that we're constantly trying to climb back into. We like see this spot that we've been ejected from and replaced with desire for something that's not ourselves. And then by taking on the desire, by desiring what ends up filling that hole, we, you know, that's kind of how we live our lives. So we pursue meaning, we pursue, you know, like X, Y, and Z, but ultimately like those are representations of that lack, that hole that we've been kicked out of. And we're trying to place our conscious selves back into it. But really what Lacan says we need to be doing instead is instead of going after that hole, we need to be going after ourselves. So we basically need to replace the pursuit of that hole with the pursuit of like our fundamental essence as like a human.
But I thought we were the thing going towards the hole.
So I mean, there's
like kind of like the, you know, like a black hole, you know, and you have like the event horizon.
Yeah, Lacan does really
everything. Then like all the information kind of ends up on like the edge of the event horizon. So I mean, I just thought that's kind of like, you know, it's almost like a whirlpool. Like, you know, there's this kind of force sucking us down that we kind of rotate around instead of actually going down in it. That sort of absence at the center of the self, kind of an avoidance of it, is what we are.
Yeah, I would almost kind of split this into like a dualistic way of looking at it, where like that's one half, where there's just this continuous loss that we experience as part of our lives, because eventually we will die. And then on the other side of it is like this this sort of conscious experience of what we are moving towards. And so like, I think on a very real level that transcends consciousness, it is characterized by loss, like you're saying, by inevitability. But within like the subjective experience of the conscious realm, it's characterized more by like accumulation to try to stave off that loss.
Bullshit.
This is sort of
accumulation as a thing. I want to bring it back because I do think if we can all agree that, you know, I love this, and I think we can all agree that like there is this truth to what you're describing in that.
Right. But ultimately it's just a story. Yeah, and that's the thing. It's like I'm going to tell you, I'm not, you know, aiming to present this framework as the way that this metaphysical reality.
Right.
But I certainly like hold it.
I wasn't saying that the story, Michael, is bullshit. I was saying the stuff that we accumulate. That very last line, the stuff we accumulate is the bullshit that we tack on. I think coming back to, you know, let's assume that's what we're striving for. I think Frankfurt would say that bad actors are people who stand between you, that nirvana, or that like sort of cohesion you strive for. So, and bullshitters are like a more damaging obstacle in your path than liar and accumulating a bunch of stuff, you know, worldly bullshit that get in your way. Like, I do think that there's a, we can categorize bullshit story that you're describing hands in our way towards what Frankfurt called truth, but what we might call nirvana or self. What do you think? Am I forcing it too much, trying to link Frankfurt back to?
I have thoughts, but I want to give other people a chance to talk.
Yeah. Here's, I don't mean to pull this out of Lacan. I don't want to bullshit on it because I don't understand it at all.
Totally.
Don't restrict yourself.
I had he posed a question in the text that he said should be an exercise for the reader that I'd be interested in tackling, but we kind of have to assume that bullshit is a thing, and that all the baggage that comes with that, that there's some sort of truth that people can hold in their minds. But he says he addresses that for some reason in our society it's more acceptable to bullshit than to lie. And I wish he like kind of talked more about why that is, but he says that the problem of understanding why our attitude towards bullshit is generally more benign than our attitude towards lying, is an important one, which I shall leave as an exercise for the reader. So do you agree that society views bullshit as more acceptable than lying, and do you have an idea of why that is?
Doesn't he use the word tolerable at some point too? Like, it's just bullshit is more tolerable?
Yeah. Yep. And then he also says, so he says the distinction, like, he kind of hints at it. He says that lying is a sharp focus designed to insert a particular falsehood into somebody's mind. So my thinking was kind of that, just to take the same example I've been using, if I said to people that I graduated with a 3.9 GPA, that would be a lie. If I said, and I know Michael, you have some conflict with this, but if I said, I was a great student, I was really organized, that's more bullshit. Amen. And people take the fact as like a fact at face value. So they say that, oh, he says he got a 3.9 GPA, either that's 100% true, or he's a liar. But they can take me saying, oh, I was a great student. I'm a teacher's
life. What does it mean to you to be a great student?
Exactly. Well, so people expect you to speak like hyperbolically about yourself and to promote yourself. And they take that factor into consideration when they're listening to you. One is you are either, it's a binary almost, you're either telling the truth about it or you're deliberately manipulating. The other is just kind of the way people are expected to talk, and it's not seen as like as insidious or manipulative because there's like a shared agreement that people do have inflated perceptions of themselves and try to promote themselves.
So wait, I have a response to this edit because I'm loving this. I think in our data-driven world now, like, people have really obsessed over this point, which is that quantitative figures are harder to bullshit than qualitative figures. You know, 3.9 is harder to bullshit, good student. But then there's this new meta conversation happening, which is that people who define those quantitative measures can inject sense of bias. So one might call a 3.9 GPA complete bullshit because it's a sort of corrupt system defined what creates the circumstance gave you a GPA, right? Like I would say, if we're going to get very zoomed out on this and a little cynical, you know, the depths of like the world that I feel like I find a lot of turmoil in, that yeah, like that 3.9 is just as much bullshit as you saying you're a good student. You know, like, it's all bullshit because it's all been defined sort of relativistic from a relativistic starting.
Oh, I mean, you're saying that academic credentialism is bullshit?
I think a lot of people would agree with that particular one, but people make this case across the board.
I think more broadly,
I really wanted to agree with that.
I think you can. You should.
I think more broadly, you can say that like there's obviously like ways of presenting statistics that are dishonest and still true. So you can like selectively say, like, I'm trying to think of how this would apply to my academic record, but I could say like, oh, I got a 3.9 GPA. I was a great student, but I could have just like cheated, which would have made me a bad student because I'm just selecting one metric and not saying like, oh, I also got expelled.
There's opportunities for bullshit all along the way.
You are bullshitting and being dishonest, even though you're telling the truth.
I think there's opportunities of bullshitting all along the way, right? Like, there's the initial opportunity of bullshit, who created the test or whatever, what's in your numerical result. Then there's your opportunity to cheat. And then, like you said just a second ago, like, there's also the opportunity to present the bullshit, right? Like, there's all those examples of who's like putting a massive break in their graphs. You know, like, you can make COVID results look, or COVID numbers in this planet look really, really low if you just like tweak the y-axis the right way, right? That's another way to bullshit. Right?
I actually love this because this like this directly applies to my job and working at a charter school. And I hope this recording doesn't get around. I haven't said my last name. But like, yeah, we're like so data driven, and like on all our websites, it's like, oh, 99% of our high school graduates are accepted into college, but they don't mention like part, like one of their classes in high school, I think, is just like writing college applications. Like, you're required to send them out if you're in high school. And if you've made it to be a senior in our high schools, it's because like we weeded out people that can't apply to college or like aren't performing well enough. So it's a true fact, but it's completely covering up like the truth of the situation.
Right. They might as well call it the GPA bullshit club.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that's like the conflict that's going on within our school system right now. So it's just interesting that you brought that up.
Well, I think it's a good thing that people strive for authenticity, that it causes, if there's a conflict, that means progress.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. I want to maybe then kind of offer a different take on bullshit. Well, okay. So we talked about Nathan saying, I'm praying for you. And it takes on this extra meaning because we all sort of have the shared understanding, right? And so what happens when you talk to somebody who doesn't have the shared understanding? And so I think like a lot of us today as a society sort of have the shared understanding that like the truth is like, you know, beyond our grasp. And we're a lot more willing to tolerate people taking creative liberties with things that they, you know, communicate in language. And so when we do that, when we take creative liberties, we're making an assumption, like we're assuming that we know our audience and what their understanding is. And so when we're correct, then this extra meaning gets conveyed. So Nathan says, I'm praying for you. And you know what? The joke lands, the sarcasm lands. Or, I'm sorry, you're saying it's sincere, but like, I think that, yeah, there is sort of this
extra meaning. Unfortunately, it kind of, meaning as we found out, it missed.
Well, I mean, I think it landed. Anyway, so basically, like, you know, the audience needs to have the shared understanding for it to land. What happens when they don't have the shared understanding? Then at that point, the audience will see this creative liberty as being false, when in reality, the speaker does have a sincere message that they're trying to say. It's just part of the message is left unsaid. And so because of this, it's not that the bullshitter is bullshitting. It's that the listener has detected bullshit. And really where the bullshit originates from is not in the speaker, but in the listener. And the speaker could lie or tell the truth, or, you know, say what they believe to be the truth or say what they believe to be a lie. But that's not where the bullshit is. The bullshit is in people without this extra level of context, this part that's left unsaid.
I feel like,
so like with Trump.
I feel like I've seen that play out, like to live this multilingual or had this whole upbringing. There's lots of fans see that and they walk away from the conversation not trusting that person. It's because
exactly
like the bullshit originated with, I don't know, with Trump. I would say the bullshit originates with him. I want to hear what you have.
Well, so, okay. Yeah. So with Trump, you know, if he points at a picture that has nobody in it, he says, look at that huge crowd. The part that's left unsaid is that facts don't matter. But we don't have this shared understanding. You know, we sort of have a different one. We believe that, you know, objective reality may be out of our grasp, but like we can try to approximate it. And like, you know, facts, you know, do matter, you know, at least to some degree. And so we just, you know, so we perceive what Trump is saying as a deliberate obscuring of what he believes to be true. But the reality is just that we're not really inferring the extra level of meaning that Trump is trying to convey with what's left unsaid. But ultimately, Trump has an awful message, which is that facts don't matter.
Right.
So, I mean, that's a bad shared understanding to have. But I think that's what that is what's happening. It's not technically him saying bullshit. It's more of like us perceiving it as bullshit because we have a different understanding.
Well, that's I think the bigger problem is that the media in general doesn't give a shit. You know,
yeah, like, I mean,
the world we live in does not really care about facts, you know, especially, I mean, even the people on the internet, you know, even those who say, oh, you know, facts are everything to me. For the most part, that's just the posture because they want to seem like the kinds of people.
Right.
They like to think of themselves as the kind of person who cares about facts.
Okay, so are those two, is it incompatible to hold the belief that A, objective reality is beyond the limits of our understanding, and also B, facts matter? Are those completely incompatible viewpoints?
Well, I think the bigger problem, sorry, let me just finish this real quick. The bigger problem is not what the facts are. It's how you tie the facts together and tell a story with them. You know, there's lots of facts, but, you know, you can never, there's no story that can encompass all of them, you know? And so it's which ones do you elevate to importance or not?
Right. So a fact, so
the news doesn't lie. The news doesn't tell you, give you false facts. They just give you real facts in a way that is bullshit.
It seems like a fact is almost like a partial shared understanding. And by accumulating facts, we build a shared understanding. And so to say that facts don't matter using that definition means that we just can't achieve a shared understanding. It's not actually trying to connect a fact to what's true, but rather a fact as like a unit of shared understanding.
I'm on board. I'm curious what Ed had to say here.
Oh, I guess I made a fear joke. That's my bad.
Facts don't care about your feelings.
Yeah.
Well, I think I agree with
Well, his feelings certainly don't care about facts.
Yeah. I agree with Michael where it's like if two people are interacting and one of us thinks that facts don't matter and the other one that facts, then yeah, the it's almost like bullshit. It's going to feel like both sides are bullshitting to each other.
I think the issue here is that Trump is lying. I mean, Trump depends on facts. Like he gets news, you know, it's from awful sources, but like this news is presented to him as a series of facts from people who inform him, his advisors. So he does care about facts. And what he's doing is he is lying to say that he doesn't care about facts. And then that is the, you know, the extra part that's left unsaid that gives context to what he says at face value.
Yeah, but isn't the bullshit part like how he kind of like he uses facts but like they're not right? Like so in that article, like the Time article, you know, something's like, oh, like your premiums are gonna go up, or like, you know, Obama raised, you know, your premiums went up by like 50% or 35, 45, 50% or whatever. And like the real number is like 5%. So the bullshit is like it's not a lie, but it's not, it's misinformation. It's bullshit. It's bullshit. I don't know how else to describe it.
Yeah, I feel like I'm going to, at least the way I interpret it is that Trump is a liar, but nobody can, he's not a bullshitter in the sense that nobody can be a bullshitter, only be perceived as a bullshitter. Because I think what Trump is earnestly trying to do by misconstruing things that are like so clearly on their face, one thing and calling them another, like swapping 5 with 15 or 50 or whatever, is that what's left unsaid is that he is also trying to convey that he doesn't care about facts, but he does, which is a lie. And in that sense, that's the essence of him being a liar. And then we perceive it as bullshit because we have a very different understanding. I don't want to keep repeating myself, though. I feel like maybe that's what
I'm doing. I'm hearing what we're talking about, and I'm just thinking, like, I feel like we're 4 years too late for, like, Trump's been silenced now. Like, he's kind of gone from the public. Like, I guess I'm more interested now in bullshit that Biden's pulling, like how $2,000 becomes $1,400.
Right. That's a good example.
You know what I mean? Like, these are the relevant, this is the relevant bullshit, political bullshit to 2021. I feel like we're literally 4 years. Like, I was almost wondering if this is like some desire to go back 4 years.
But Nathan,
almost be better to relive the Trump presidency than to confront whatever's coming.
Sorry, friend, what were you going
to
say?
I do want to, you know, Dylan posted this great link by the author here, Frankfurt, in Time from 4 years ago, or even more than, about Trump being a bullshitter. And how opportune. I couldn't agree more. You know, like, this would have been a great conversation I've had 4 years ago. But wait. There's a great moment here where he spells out the way that Trump's lies are bullshit. If I may, like, you know, I'm sort of like, I'm scanning this quickly, so forgive me, but I really want to respond to Michael with this because I think I agree with what Wolfert outlines here. He writes, when Trump said that he observed thousands on Jersey City celebrating the destruction of Twin Towers by dancing in the streets, it is clear enough that he was lying. Then he says a bunch of other stuff about how obvious that was a lie. And then he says, however, it is often uncertain whether Trump actually cares about the truth of what he says. This makes it unclear whether his assertion is a lie or merely bullshit. Since a person does not lie unless he makes an assertion that himself takes to be false, we cannot properly say that he is lying if he actually believes what he says. So this does come to what Michael, which is like his objective reality is just different than and that's why it's bullshit, you know?
Yeah, I think what Harry misses the mark on, and I'm sorry to declare open war on him, but I think where he misses the mark is that Trump's intention, what he's trying to communicate, is not just the words. It is that which Trump leaves unsaid. And in that sense, he is being authentic. Like, he does care.
Sure.
I was also going to say, I think it is still important, and I absolutely agree, we need to hold Biden accountable and, you know, pay attention to him and not be distracted by Trump. The reason I think that it is important to still understand Trump is because, I mean, I don't want to be too, you know, pessimistic, but in 4 years, we could very likely have the next Trumpist, not Donald Trump, but whoever is, you know, going to take on that mantle. And I think we might expect to see very similar tactics. So the better we understand them as used in Trump, you know, that could equip us to nip, you know, the next, you know, kind of fascist candidate in the bud.
Or it's a huge disservice to the four of us because we're going to be so frustrated when that happens. Or five of us, sorry.
Oh, Mike, I fully like, I mean, of course the Trump phenomenon's not over. I guess the main thing is, I just, again, like, it in some way feels to me like we can't handle the current reality. Like, the current reality is actually scarier than Trump. And I guess I just kind of want to confront that, you know, because, like, I definitely feel like Trump's incompetence was maybe the best thing about him in some ways. Like, things could have been so much worse. And it's kind of been amazing that it only was, like, garden variety Republican and not, like, full-on fascism.
I think that it is fascism. I didn't used to think that, but I do, and I'm happy to defend it now.
It is, but I mean, in the sense, but it's not Trump that's the fascist. I guess what I've always felt like throughout these last 4 years is that everyone thinks that, oh, America's good. Like, we're not fascist, but there's this evil fascist guy who's going to make us that way. And what I think is far more true is that America's fascist to the core.
Right.
And we finally had someone like,
Some say that fascism is just a direct response to capitalism. It's like
one method to resolve the contradictions of capital. Yeah,
there we go. Yeah. And so I think what Trump is doing is effectively declaring a war on truth. Like, he is being very sincere about that. But that is the political message that he's trying to spread. And I think that is inherently part and parcel of fascism. Not that every, you know, relativist is fascist. But in order to be fascist, you must construct your meaning entirely from mythos and stories and meaning and theory, as opposed to, you know, a scientific mode of analysis.
Okay, but how is that limited to Trump?
Oh, yeah, like, it's
that's
not.
The, I mean, that's dude, the point fucking, I mean.
Is that... Biden is appointing, did you see that? Biden's going to appoint a reality czar.
To who? I did not see this.
It's, I don't even have the words. It's just kind of sad. But, like, the idea that there's now going to be, like, a government-appointed official in charge of, like, providing us with reality. It's just
like the realities are.
That's
the realities are. Yeah.
Oh my god,
that's pretty bad. That's not a good thing to have done. But But yeah,
I got to be honest, the thing I liked most about Trump was how obviously bumbling, you know, it's kind of like, it's almost like that difference between, like, Trump was bullshitting to us, you know, like he was obviously misrepresenting himself. But like, I almost feel like now we're just going like straight into lies.
Well, here's the thing that's different is that Trump was, by virtue of declaring war on truth, an ideologue. Like, he was pushing an ideological agenda, one that, you know, one might say is fascist or not. That's beside the point. Whereas somebody like Biden, a neoliberal, is not an ideologue. And so what they're construing is this, like, you know, facade of caring about the truth, you know, appointing a reality star. But the reality is that truly capitalism is devoid of ideology. And so fundamentally, like, you know, the capitalist machine is manifested through Biden and, you know, the White House and yada, yada, yada. Like, it's not exactly a person, but that that machine itself fundamentally does not care about the truth because it is inhuman.
Yeah, but I mean, for it to function well, it has to provide some spectacle. Like, that's the whole thing, is that it functions best when...
Yeah, when it does maintain an illusion of truth.
Yeah, you know, I mean...
Right.
Yeah,
but I think that is consistent with what I'm saying, is that, like, it does have a facade of caring about truth, i.e. the reality star, but the actual reality is that it doesn't.
Yeah, I think I agree with that take, Michael. And I think one of the sad, I don't mean to use this word now, I don't mean it in the same context, but the sad reality of the moment is that, like, the Democrats are the pure capitalists, right? Like, they just want to get out of the way of capital. Whereas Trump was this twisted thing that, almost, you know, like, Republicans, not just Trump, but all Republicans want to bend government inappropriately benefit already rich, right? Like a good leftist would want to curtail the rich. The Democrats just wanted to the money to flow freely into rich people's pockets. The Republicans literally want to break the rules, more money in rich people's pockets than they actually would under a, like, unfettered market. So that's the broken reality. That's where the ideologue thing that you're bringing up here comes. It's not a very good capitalist, right?
Exactly, because a perfect capitalist is invisible.
Yeah, yeah, like Biden is trying to be, right?
Right.
Yep.
Yeah,
which is transparent.
You have your choice right now of the fascist or the capitalist. How do you want to vote?
Yeah, exactly. It's miserable.
Yeah, well, I don't know. I got to be honest. I mean, I don't think we're out of the fascist trap.
Oh, no.
You know, I mean
we've had fascism this whole time. It just hasn't been wearing, like, you know, Hugo Boss and army gear.
Yeah, I kind of miss it being up front, to be quite honest. I liked seeing it. Trump was really the best face for America in its reality.
I mean, I think the reality, though, is just we don't see it. I mean, it's people like us who don't have this, like, you know, psychopath character. And as a result, we don't go into politics. We're not, like, chomping at the bit to make as much money as we can. Like, we're normal people. And, you know, because so much of communication, like I think we were talking about with the DeBoard board game being, you know, sort of dropped, is that when communication is mediated by money, then the messages that come across are, you know, those that align with, you know, money as a virtue or power as a virtue. Whereas those of us that don't feel that way, it just doesn't make it through the communication structure of liberal democracy. So it's there. I mean, there's people like us everywhere. It's right. Just we have a very, very, very hard time finding each other.
Right.
Did anybody have any other thoughts on bullshit?
I wanted to tell Nathan that I'm reading Bullshit Jobs now and I'm enjoying it a lot. So thank you for the recommendation.
Oh, hell yeah. I was going to say, his book, I mean, the other two books of his that just, like, top shelf for me are Utopia of Rules was a great one. And then Debt just blew my mind six ways.
I just got a copy of Debt. I have yet to start it.
I would really like to hear your opinion on it.
Well, should we name a book to read? You know, I loved Bullshit Jobs, at least what I gleaned from it.
I
would read another book by Graeber.
I'm not opposed to reading David Graeber. I just want to put forth one contender.
It's not really philosophy.
Which is, oh, sorry?
I wouldn't necessarily call it philosophy. Graeber.
Yeah, I mean, anthropology, economics, all that stuff is super interesting, probably to all of us. The thing that I wanted to bring up
All knowledge was, is philosophy.
I came across this paper. It's 19 pages, and it's an overview of the philosophy of Bataille. And so this was a French surrealist philosopher. And he basically wrote an alternative form of economics that is different than Marxism. specifically, this paper relates Bataille's conception of Eros and eroticism. So we've been reading a lot about that with Eros and Civilization, and Civilization is discontents and denial of death. So it seems to me that continuing with the Eros theme, especially as a gateway into a very well, easily read and very, very, very interesting. This is one of the most interesting things I've read in a long time. Essay on Bataille's philosophy could be very fruitful for all of us. I think we'd enjoy it.
I'm game.
And also, yep. Okay, cool.
I mean, if it's 19 pages, Eddie can actually get through it.
I can.
It's 19 pages, but I mean, and it's not. I wouldn't say it's very hard, but it is. There's a lot there. It's really interesting. So I'll put a link to it in the chat.
I mean, yeah, I also had
you know, since you guys, since no one could handle Discipline and Punish, I found a more kind of modern version that I feel gets the points across and is something of a modern update. Maybe for a recent one coming up, I really would like us to fit it in. And it's a Weapons of Math Destruction.
Is it mine?
I feel like I've heard that.
I forget her name, but it's essentially, when we look at the way in which like algorithms for like sorting people kind of arbitrarily, and you know, especially when we talk about things like, you know, there's a lot of talk about like structural racism. Right. I think it's you know, in honor of Black History Month and reflecting upon, you know, the ways in which Black people are, you know, controlled and fucked with by bureaucracies and our government, and pretty much how we all are kind of grouped by these pretty perverse algorithms and like rational procedures, and the ways in which kind of the past and past data kind of reinforces like future decisions.
I'm on board with that one too. I think I heard that author interviews, you know, this summer maybe. Is that when the book came out? Last summer?
I don't know. I don't know when it came out, but it's she writes very well, very clear, and quite horrific if you see, you know, some of the implications. I just think it's
like
very
the idea,
something to
I like the idea of doing a book, but realistically, about the amount of time I'm gonna have, an essay would be something I'd
oh,
have
yeah,
a lot,
no.
A lot
I was thinking for the next one, let's just do the essay, but
and then maybe a book next
coming time. Coming up soon, I'd really like to cover that one.
Yeah.
Definitely.
If you guys don't want to read Foucault, then at least read this.
Yeah. I think there's another something else that this brings to mind, which is of I think came up at a similar time in my life. Something called pleasure activism. Oh, I think I sent Michael the photo of Kara Reed and just about, you know, to have a slightly more optimistic take, which is like, given the difficult situations that we're faced with, how to interact with them in a way that, you know, it's pleasure activism. It's all in the word, right, Kara?
You mean you only do the activism that feels good, or
it's a very Nietzschean affirmative mode to living.
But for next week, erotic exuberance.
Yeah, I think we're gonna do 2 weeks, right?
Oh yeah, 2 weeks. I might not be able to.
I've already read it, so I mean, I'm happy to if we want to do it in a week. And I read it in I think a day or two, I'll leave it up to y'all. You said you wouldn't be able to meet in two.
I wouldn't be able to meet. I would be able to meet. No.
Would next week work for people?
I'll be up all night for the next 7 nights getting through these 17 pages, but I'll.
Okay. All right. So let's say
you can do it, Eddie.
Oh my God, this does look dense.
Okay. But yeah, I can post my notes too. It's I will say it's not, there's not a lot of confusing words, but it's very rich, and so it's gonna take more than one session to read it.
Yeah.
Like maybe break it up or something like that. But highly recommend.
Yeah.
I've got to hop off.
Yeah. Hmm.
This was awesome. I really enjoyed this. And please keep going
I gotta take off too. This was fun.
And I have the recording here. Should I send it to you, Michael, or do you want me to just upload it somewhere, or I'll upload it onto like Google Drive and.
Perfect. Yeah, thank you so much.